Last week, I know y'all are happy to be here this week, right? Really? Man. Hey, can you pretend you're glad to be here? Woo! Come on, let's give Jesus some praise this morning. Hey, we got a week off. The Lord gave us a break. Now it's time for us to repay him and lift that name on high. Amen. You know, the Lord says that he'll never leave us, he'll never forsake us, and that when two or more are gathered together in his name, he is here in the midst. Lord is here this morning. Let him speak to you. Listen to him. Open up your hearts. Open up your minds. Let's hear what God has to say. I say it every Sunday. If you're here this morning, you don't know Jesus, you do not have to leave that way. I promise you, it'll be the greatest decision you've ever made in your life. Let's bow. Let's have a word of prayer this morning. Our most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, as we humbly bow in your presence, Lord, we just want to thank you for all the wonderful blessings you've given us. Lord, we just thank you for blessing us with another day of life, Father. Lord, we know that you're here. Lord, we just pray that you let your presence come and just flood this place, Father, that there not be one person that can't feel you. Lord, we pray that decisions be made today. Lord, if there be one here that doesn't know your son, Jesus, we pray that today be the day of salvation. Be with Brother Isaiah, give him the words you'd have him to say and hide him behind the cross. Lord, let everything we do be for your praise, honor, and glory. Father, just so we know that we're not praising for the one next to us, but we're praising for you. We are here for an audience of one, Father. We love you. We praise you. It's the last name I pray. Amen.
Place for me. I'm a child of God. hear moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here working in this place. I worship you.
Stop working, even when I don't see it.
never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper,
Exodus chapter 3, Exodus chapter 3 and Psalm chapter 46. If you have your Bible today, flip to those two places. We're going to use a couple, three verses to kind of springboard this morning to where we're going to go. Sat down and studied some last week, and I had this thought. And as I sat and looked at the Word of God, and I pray this morning that this helps and feeds you the way that it helped and fed my soul. But the older that I get, the more thankful I am for the presence of God. And if we're all being honest, we live in a social media, what I call a social media Christmas card society. And in essence, all you're seeing is surface level. You see the happy couple and the chocolate cake and the 2.5 kids and the white picket fence and the dog that got the Christmas scarf. And if that were only reality, but the truth of the matter is life comes with its own circumstances, its own problems, its own stressors, comes with its own disappointments and discouragements, comes with, the wisest man in the ever lived penned the words about times and seasons in Ecclesiastes 3. And there are different times and seasons of our life. I'll bet that you've had some times and seasons in your life where you were happy, filled with joy. And then there have probably been times and seasons of uncertainty and doubt. And times and seasons of peace, and then there's been times and seasons of fear. And I'm thankful for, as Matt said, a God that never leaves us. And the older that I get, the more that I am thankful for God's presence in my present circumstance or situation. And this is what I want to show you in the Word of God today, because so many of the verses are written in the present tense. Look with me, stand this morning as we are. We're going to start in Exodus chapter 3. I want to show you two other verses, but I want you to notice the way that God describes Himself. Exodus 3:14, and God said to Moses, I am who I am. And He said, thus you shall say to the children of Israel, I am has sent me to you. Psalm 46:5. God is. Say that with me this morning. God is. In the midst of her, she shall not be moved. God shall help her, and that right early. Now let's read verse 7 down through verse 11. The Lord of hosts is with us. Do you see that? Say amen. Matt said this morning, where two or three are gathered, that means God is here. The God of Jacob is our refuge, Selah. Come, behold the works of the Lord, what desolations He has made in the earth. He makes wars to cease until the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and cuts the spear in two. He burns the chariot in the fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Let's pray. Father God, thank You for this day. Lord, we thank You for all Your many blessings. And Lord, I thank You for this, Your church. Lord, now we ask that You would speak to us as only You can and do. Lord, I pray that You would use Your word this morning. Lord, that it would find resting and lodging place in our hearts and our minds. Lord, help us to be doers of it. And Lord, I pray that it's Your voice that's heard today, not mine. Lord, bless, move, speak. And Lord, we ask that You would just continue to bless this church and the time we get to spend together this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. We've got to start here, and I alluded to it in the introduction, and I hope you saw it in the text. If not, you've got a lot more opportunity coming up. But God is. So many times we, I think, look over the obvious. And what I mean by that is that God is saying, I am. He is writing it in the present tense. Now, part of our issue as believers is that sometimes if we're not careful, we can refer to our walk with the Lord in past tense. Amen, if you understand. Let me expound a little. Because sometimes what I think isn't always what comes out of my mouth. It's part of having this thing called ADD. And what I mean to say is that I don't know about you, but I've been guilty before of referring to a relationship in the past tense with my God. There was a time when I was on fire. There was a time in my life where I did study my Bible. I used to have an active prayer life. I used to serve. There was a time when, amen, if you get it now. Yeah. Sometimes we can look backward and we refer to the past, and God is saying, I am ever present. I am ever present in your circumstance. And I think that this is one of the titles that God gives Himself, but Satan also gives himself the title, and the Word gives him the title, the father of lies, the accuser, the thief. And as I began poring over all of this, I think that Satan has a way of coming along and making us doubt a whole lot of stuff and warping our thinking. And he has a way of also making me think that I'm the only one that feels this way. I'm the only one that's dealing with this. Everybody else has these beautiful Christmas cards. I'm the only one that's feeling discouraged. I'm the only one that's scared. I'm the only one. Amen, if you get it. And what God is saying is that, no. Isaiah, whatever your need is, I'm not a was God, I'm an is God. I didn't go on vacation and I don't take sabbaticals. I'm here. And this is what he's telling his people. This is what he told Moses. I am, I am, I am. This is what he's telling Israel time and time again. God is, God is, God is. And if I could summarize everything that I'm about to preach into one tiny, just one little statement, it is that God is whatever you need in this present time. And there's the title of your sermon this morning, God's Presence in My Present. God is very interested, compassionate, loving, and caring about what you are going through right now in this moment for whatever it is that you need. I preached last week and I talked about how that Jesus, or the week before last, I missed the snow day, so y'all buckle up. I've got a lot to say. I preached about Jesus' availability, how he made himself available. And if you look at Jesus' ministry and you look at the way that God deals with people, everybody had a different need. But he made himself available in those. The woman that had the issue of blood needed healing. And Jesus was her healing. I thought about Zacchaeus needed the gospel. And Jesus gave it to him. Nicodemus needed doctrine, while the Apostle Paul needed light. The multitude needed to be fed. The multitude needed to be taught. The disciples needed to be discipled. When they needed the storm calmed, he did it. Moses needed a burning bush. Gideon needed a fleece. And all of humanity needed a Savior. You can keep going through this. And this is the way that God, the prophet Daniel needed protection. God gave it to him. Time and time again, what you find is that when people call on God, he gives them what they need when they need it because he's an is God, not a was God. And here's the beautiful thing about Scripture. If we're all going to be transparent and wildly honest this morning, sometimes we go through seasons of life where you don't even know what you need. And if somebody said, Isaiah, how can I help you? What do you need right now? You go through seasons of life where you can't even pinpoint what it is that you're feeling. I don't know what this is. I don't know what I'm feeling. And I don't know about you, but if I'm to be honest, there's been times when I've prayed before God, I don't even know what I need, but you do, fill me with it. And that's one of the things I love about God is that the Word says even when I don't know what to say and how to pray or what to pray, that the Spirit intercedes on my behalf with groanings and utterings. Even when I don't know what I need, God does. And when I'm going through something presently, God says, my presence is there for you, and I'll give you what you need, even when you don't know what that is, Isaiah. The older I get, the more thankful I am for God's presence. God's presence in my present problem. Because life's in a perpetual state of change. Oftentimes in my line of work, I have a front row seat to the, I don't know if we could call it the side effects of sin, problems, just situations and circumstances. I've seen it in my own life. I've seen it in the lives of many others. I watch it play out on a day-by-day basis. And maybe God created me ADD because he knew that I would need something different every day, but there's something different every day. And I don't know about you, but in my line of work, it's like any given day could be a huge roller coaster, right? I love this church, and I love the people that come, and I'll get a phone call, my phone call ring, and or my phone will go off, and I will look at a text, and it's a family welcoming a brand new baby boy or girl into this word, and they're celebrating, and it's like, man, that's awesome. And I'll say, congratulations, I'm so excited for you guys. Can't wait to hold the baby and to spoil he or her. And then 5 seconds later, my phone will ring, and they'll say, Pastor, we just lost mom. Man, that changed quickly. Life has a way of doing that, though, doesn't it? You don't have to be a minister or a pastor to get those phone calls and know what those seasons feel like. And this is, again, I don't want to beat a dead horse, but this is the thing that I love about the Lord, is that whatever my need is, He's got something for that. And so I want to preach through this a little bit. The problem, I'm guilty. God's presence, mercy is present. Look at Deuteronomy 4:31. For the Lord your God is, do you see that? Say amen. Do you see the pattern now? You see the pattern? We're not talking about, I'm not preaching on potential. I'm preaching on looking at patterns. Look at this. God is a merciful God. He will not forsake you, nor destroy you, nor forget the covenant of your fathers, which He swore to them. I'm guilty. You're guilty. This is a universal problem, and this is the gospel message. You're not alone in that. We've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. This isn't something that is just applicable to you or to I. It's universal. It's in totality. Everybody's in literally the same boat. God says, no, I understand you don't deserve it. I understand you don't deserve forgiveness. I understand you're a sinner. I already told you that. I declared it in my word. But what I'm telling you, Isaiah, is at the moment when you realize you're a sinner in need of a Savior, I'm not giving you judgment. I'm giving you grace. And the definition of grace, literally, unmerited favor. You don't deserve my son, but I gave him to you anyway. That's why my word calls it a gift. It's mercy. And the psalmist said, His mercy endures forever. Romans 10:9, that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. That's God's presence in your problem. If you're here today and lost, it's not that God was salvation, it's that God is salvation. It's not that Jesus used to save people, He still is saving people. That is literally the mission statement that He gave to the whole world. Why did you come, Jesus? To seek and to save that which is lost. And if He's seeking you today, I hope and pray that today will be the day that you get saved. Number two, problem, I feel weak. God's presence, power, and strength in my present. I don't know about you, but sometimes I'm trying to be transparent with you this morning. With four kids and the schedule that I keep, sometimes I get weak. I get burned down, run down. Anybody else here in the Quattro Club? But here's the thing. I felt like that too when I had one kid and two kids. I tell people, that's my kid breakdown. One's life-changing. And you don't know how life-changing it is till you have such said child. And then something as simple as going to church or going to the movies now requires you to pack a bag like you're going on a trip. Two isn't as bad. Hey, you've got one, she's got one, you've got one, he's got one, tag team. Three's where you really need to pray. I'm helping you. I'm trying to help you. Three's where you need to, by all things, prayer and supplication. Philippians 4:6. You better do that. Because now here's the breakdown. You got one, she's got one, then you got a floater. Anybody? Amen if you got three or more. Am I preaching truth? The floater's the one where you get artwork on the wall and plumbing issues and all. Amen. Hypothetically speaking, this never happened in the super family household, but, I mean, they could take an entire family size from Sam's Club thing of baby powder and dump it out in the nursery floor. 2 years later, you could still be sweeping up baby powder out of a, no, I'm just saying that it could happen. Hypothetically, not that one of my kids named Abel might have done that, but I'm just saying that. Hypothetically, church. At 3 years, 3 or 4 years old, he was our floater, and that's what we got. 4, you might as well just pull a trace. It's fine. You can have the oldest one take care of the youngest. Good. Put out some bread and water, and they'll be fine. But what I'm preaching is whether you got 1, 4, or 12, I mean, whatever it is that you do for a living, there may be days where you say, man, I really enjoy my job, and then there's days when you drive home where you're like, I don't know if I can do it anymore. And there's times in this life where you feel like you can take on the world, and man, you feel the presence of God. And then there's other times where you feel all by yourself, all alone. If it happened to the prophet Elijah, it'll happen to me. And what I'm saying is, God says, Isaiah, when you feel weak, when you feel like you can't take anymore, when you feel those times where you're just like, that's it, I'm done, I'm packing it in, I'm giving up, God says, no, don't. You just feel empty. You just need some strength right now. Let me show you in His Word. 2 Samuel 22, 33. God is my strength. And is this on the screen? You guys just aren't playing anymore? We'll start over. That went different in my mind. God is my, I love you, church. And, see, that's the way I had it drawn up the first time. And He makes my way, yes. It's not that, now watch this. It's not that He's doing that and meant that for everybody else and not you. Because Satan has a way of making you feel like, I see it, Pastor. God is strength. He is power. He will make my way perfect. But that's for those people that have that pretty Facebook page and not me. No, it's you too. So, He is my strength. He is my power. Number 3, the problem. I feel helpless. God's presence helps in my presence. Look at Psalm 54:4, simple verse. Behold, God is, do you see it? Say amen. My helper. So in those moments where you feel like you're all alone, in those moments where you feel like nobody else is doing, in those moments where you feel like nobody else, in those moments where you feel like I can't take anymore, I need some help, God says, hey, Isaiah, psst, over here. If you'll call me, I'll help. Know what it says? Behold, God is my helper. So I'm talking to the person here that's maybe facing some trials, maybe is discouraged, maybe is going through some circumstances, some problems, some stressors, some situations that you don't really have the answer for. You're not really sure what to do, but it's beating you up in a really bad way, and you can't seem to get a handle on it. God says, I will help. I will help. You know, there's nothing better than getting help when you needed it the most. I'm thankful for people in my life that when I need something, I can pick up the phone and they will call and help. But watch this. Shouldn't my first call always be to God? I like getting help and I like giving help. But there's going to be times when somebody's going to need something, or I'm going to need something from somebody, and they're not going to be available to help. But it's just like I preached 2 weeks ago, God's always available. He makes Himself available. And His presence, whatever it is that I need in that moment, will come into my present situation and circumstance. And God says, Isaiah, I want to help. Psalm 46:1, God is our refuge and strength and very present help. in times of trouble. Hebrews 4:16, let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. And therein lies the disconnect. This would be like you getting frustrated with me because you needed help, and you're like, well, the pastor didn't come help me. Or me getting frustrated with you going, Matt, I needed your help. And Matt's like, I didn't know you needed my help. You didn't call. God says, like, Isaiah, if you'll call, I'll help. It's cause and effect. The problem, I've been unfaithful. God's presence is faithfulness in my presence. You see, if we're all being honest, there's sometimes when we could, that could be our honest, truthful testimony. I am faithful. I'm being faithful to what God's called me to do. And then other times where if we're being really honest, I'm not being that faithful. And if somebody pinned me down in that moment and said, what are you doing right now to further the kingdom of God, to serve and to blah, 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 all the stuff I preached 3 or 4 weeks ago, I would have to say, I don't really know or nothing. But here's the thing about God, and this goes back to grace and mercy and love, is that He's faithful even when I'm not. Let me show you in His Word. 1 Corinthians 1:9, God is, do you see that again? It's the present tense. God is faithful. God is faithful. By whom you were called unto the fellowship of His Son, Jesus Christ. I'm thankful for the faithfulness of the Father. And I thought about this, how many times and in how many ways He's been faithful when I've not. And He was faithful to save me when I called on Him. He's faithful to provide for me. He's faithful to bless. He's faithful to watch over. He's faithful. He's faithful. Problem, I've made a mess. God's presence restores my present. Look at Psalm 61. You have broken us down. You have been displeased. Oh, restore us again. The psalmist David said this very same thing when he'd made a mess of his life. When his present situation was anything but gold star worthy. And he calls on God, and God is faithful to forgive. God is faithful to restore. God is faithful to revive. But then, this is really very simple. I want to give you this really quickly. How a person deals with sin. It's all dependent. Number one, identify the problem. Identify the sin. I have to know what it is. Admit and confess the problem or the sin. Then third, take actions. Make what was wrong right. Now I want to give you one I think is the best illustration in Scripture because you see it in its totality. So let me put this first in just very simplistic terms, okay? I'm going to pick on Matt again. Let's say that as I'm leaving today, Matt's got a beautiful truck. Let's say that I go to back up and I hit the gas too hard and I just cream Matt's truck. Now I have to identify the problem. The problem is evident. I have hit Matt's truck. But now I have to take it a step further. I have to go to Matt and I say, Matt, I have to confess this. I have hit your truck. And I want you to forgive me, and I want God to forgive me. I'm sorry. Even if I did it on purpose. Still the same, right? Because somebody here, I know how people's mind works. Well, that was an accident. Even if I did it on purpose, I still got to do the same thing, right? But oftentimes, we don't even get there. Our human nature won't even allow us. Like, we get to step one, we identify the problem. I don't feel good. I'm angry. I'm bitter. Amen, right? But I don't even want to identify what's causing me or what I'm doing or what I'm not doing that's causing me to feel that way. And then I'm certainly not going to admit any wrongdoing, and I'm most certainly not going to go to Matt and say, whatever I can do to make this situation right, I'm sorry, I've sinned against you, I'm sorry, and We call insurances. I'll write you a check. I know a good body man in Lincoln. Whatever it is, I'm sorry. And I'm going to take whatever it takes to make this right. Look with me at Luke chapter 15, 11 through 24. This is the best probably example in all the Bible. It's a story that Jesus tells. Then he said, a certain man had two sons. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me. So he divided to them his livelihood. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together, journeyed to a far country, and there wasted his possessions with prodigal living. But when he had spent all, there arose a severe famine in that land, and he began to be in want. Then he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would gladly have filled his stomach with the goods that the swine ate. And no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father and will say to him, watch this, Father, I have sinned against heaven, that's God, and before you. And I am no longer worthy to be called your son. That's humility. Make me like one of your hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. Now he's going to carry it out. But when he was still a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight and am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, bring out the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet, and bring the fatted calf here and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found, and they began to be merry. That's God's reaction to when we properly deal with our sin. He's compassionate. He's faithful. But when I look at this account, I say, you know what? First and foremost, this young man recognized his mistake. But if he stops there and says, man, I wish I had just never done that. Oh, well. Back to feeding the swine and eating their food. Then the story doesn't end the same, does it? Then he confesses it. Then he actually goes to the Father and said, I'm no longer worthy to be your son. Whatever this situation calls for, whatever it takes, I'm going to make it right. I'm not hiding what I've done. You know what I've done. But if he doesn't go to the Father, he's still eating with the pigs. If he doesn't make it right, if he doesn't confess, if he doesn't deal with it, and I'm thinking about, you're probably going to hear this next week. God can restore. God can revive. God can do anything. He's just got to have all the pieces. And oftentimes that's what God does, is he gives you a piece at a time and a piece at a time and a piece at a time. And he'll help you put together your life's puzzle. But so many times we want to do that thing where, like, you put a piece in your pocket and walk away. And the picture will never be complete. That's the way I do puzzles oftentimes in my house. But God is a restorer. But you've got to take, I've got to take, we've got to take the adequate steps to allow him to restore. Last but certainly not least, I love the description of God in the present participle, perfect present participle in Exodus chapter 3. He just told Moses, I am. And I've preached this so many times. It's been such a beautiful thought to me, and God reminded me of this. This is the way that we would describe ourselves to others. I am Isaiah Super. I am 6 feet tall. I am the husband of Brandy. I am the father of Micah, Steve, and Abel, David, Lily, Grace, and Ezra, Jude. I am the pastor at Life Church. I am addicted to Oreos. It's a perfect way to describe something. But we are a lot of different things. God says, listen, that's the reason he left it just like that. He said, Moses, this situation that I'm getting ready to put you in, it's going to have highs and it's going to have lows. You're going to see the Red Sea part, and they're going to cheer for you. And then days later, they're going to talk about killing you. Highs, lows, ebbs, flows. There's going to be a time, Moses, where you're so angry, you're going to want to bust a rock. There's going to be times when you feel like giving up. There's going to be times when the people feel like giving up, and they're going to beg to go back to Egypt, the very place they're cheering about you just got them out of. So, Moses, my name to you is I Am. And if you need strength, I am your strength. If you are weak, then I am your power. Moses, if you feel discouraged, I am your helper. Amen, if you get it. I think that's the very reason God left it blank, so that we could fill it in. And even as I preached earlier, when I don't even know what I need, God does. Because he's the creator. I want to ask you this morning, what do you need? If you need to be saved, God is your salvation. You're going through a difficult season or a difficult situation, God is your helper. God's presence is here this morning. And his presence will come into any present situation that you're going through, struggling with, or dealing with right now. So my challenge to you is very simple. Whatever your need is this morning, you come. Let's pray as we stand together. Father God, thank you. Lord, thank you for being who you are, what you are, for doing what you do. Lord, we're thankful that you are our help, you are our strength, you are our power. You're a very, very present help in time of trouble. Lord, I pray that you would give us the courage, the boldness to call on you today, Lord, for whatever it is that we need. Lord, we love you. We thank you. Bless this time of invitation and bless this short church. In Jesus' name, amen.
Keep your word and your
This morning, thank you for your attention. Travis is going to be back at the life table this morning. If you want to talk to Travis, you need prayer, you want to join, any questions about salvation, you can go back there, talk to Travis. You can come up here, talk to me. Me and Matt will be up here this morning. Want to make just a few announcements. First and foremost, we print these out every week. If you want to know what's going on in the life of your church, several ways you can do that. Number one, we've got a new chalkboard. It comes right immediately to your right as you come in the door, right there in the lobby. It'll tell you all the upcoming things. As you're going down this hallway over here toward the bathroom, there is a board there that'll tell you all the different impact projects, all those things that are happening in the church. Watch the Facebook page. You can sign up for the Group Me messaging app. That'll have you plugged in there. Check the website. We also try to play these same announcements on announcement slides in the lobby and in the coffee shop and up here on the big screen. But I want to give you just a few announcements. Number one, the safety and security meeting is happening right after church. So if you want to be involved in the safety and the security of our church when we meet for corporate worship, you'll want to stay here for that meeting. It'll be in the conference room immediately after the service. So if you're on that team already, you've got a meeting. If you want to be a part of that team, you got a meeting. All right? So if you have security background or if you have medical background, you know how to do CPR and that kind of thing, please stay for that meeting. Mark your calendar Sunday night, January the 30th at 6 p.m. We're going to be having a potluck meal at 5 right before the service. So if you want to eat, bring a dish, eat, and then the youth will be doing a special service there. Also, the Good Life group is going to the Casting Crowns concert. This is in Corbin on April the 2nd. The group rate ticket price is $22. Please sign up on the sheet at the welcome table and have your money to Anita Tucker or any of the Good Life leaders no later than February the 15th. So if you're interested in doing that, let's go. Also, I want to make this announcement. We have youth stuff every Wednesday night. We follow the school calendar schedule. So if you say, like, are they meeting? Did your kids have school today? If the answer is yes, it's going on. If the answer is no, it is not happening. All right? Amen if you understand. All right. You want to be involved in that? Get involved. See Travis, all those different things. Then we do adult Bible study every Wednesday night in here in the auditorium, 6:30 Wednesday night. If you're a first-time guest, we'd love to meet you. We want to make you feel welcome. You want information about the church, go to the life table. Stop by the welcoming table before the service. You can come up, ask me, talk to Travis, get with Matt or any of our leaders. If you want to be, or if you're interested in doing a life group or getting involved in a life group or doing anything with life groups, call me. My number's in the bulletin. It's on the card. It's on the big screen. And if you don't have my number, just ask some random person here, and chances are they do, and they'll send it to you. So get that. All the impact opportunities are on the bulletin. If you have more questions about that as well, check Facebook, check the website. Hold on, I'm getting more news. What is it? Yeah, financial tax statements, if you gave to the church through Tithely, they're out there on the table as you walk out these middle doors immediately to your right. Grab those and give them to your CPA or whoever it is that does your taxes, or the person that does your taxes. We are currently seeking people that are interested in being a part of the drama team. So if you want to be involved in acting and singing and dancing and or any of the above, and you're interested in doing a skit or something like that, hey, get with them. After contact Julie Shepherd or Holly Whitaker. Their number's on this little piece of paper. Grab one before you leave. And if you're interested in serving in any capacity, call us. Call us. We'll put you to work. We would love to put you to work. Amen, church? All right, listen, I hope you have a good week. Let's pray it out. Father God, thank you. Thank you for this day. And Lord, thank you for all the blessings that you bestow upon us, for the provision to life. We thank you for your love and your grace and your mercy. And Lord, I thank you for just allowing me the privilege to pastor such a wonderful church. Lord, we ask that you would continue to bless, add to it as you see fit. And Lord, we pray that you bless all the ministries taking place this week. Lord, we love you. We thank you most of all for Jesus, and it's in his name we pray. Amen.